On March 7th, 2011, the finance bros of Wall Street broke the speed of light. Or more specifically, they found a way of transferring information at twice the velocity of fiber optic internet, and in doing so, made an obscene amount of money through high-speed trading. They hadn't discovered some new sort of science, but rather repurposed a Cold War microwave relay, with towers so ubiquitous that if you live in the States, you probably pass one of them at least once a day. It's called long lines and was developed by AT&T. It carried transcontinental phone calls, live-streamed the moon landings, delivered us dial-up internet, and was then abandoned. Today, we're going inside the network to discover what secrets it may hold. Connecting together the widely distributed population centers of America has always been a challenge. Early telephone relied on copper cables, with a switchboard operator manually connecting the caller and recipient. That worked fine inside of cities, but as soon as you wanted to go between them, things got difficult. Snaking those cables up and down mountains was a massive pain. On top of that, each wire could carry only a single call, meaning that you had to bundle hundreds of them together in a fat wad to get any sort of meaningful service. Even so, congestion between cities was rife. In 1945, the end of World War II saw massive urbanization and booming business, driving the need for a coast-to-coast communications network that actually worked. Initially, the engineers at Bell Systems were going to just add in a bunch more cable, but soon came up with a better idea. A network of towers and antenna that turned the skies into the first ever information superhighway. The first problem was in creating an antenna that could go the distance. The further the signal could travel, then the fewer towers needed to be built, reducing the time and cost of setting up the network. For the same input power, a signal can be received further away if all of its energy is directed in a narrow beam. A simple rod antenna produces an even spread. That's fine for radio, but we can do better. If you add in some side supports, we can reflect the signals in roughly the right direction, and if we make them in the shape of a parabola, then we can produce an extra tight beam. Initially, long lines used square horns, but as manufacturing tech developed, a conical version rose to dominance that was better able to replicate this ideal shape. By adapting these designs, the long lines horn antenna were able to focus their power into a narrow 1-degree beam, capable of being detected over 100 kilometers away. On a typical station such as this, you'd use four antenna: an upstream receiver, downstream transmitter, downstream receiver, and upstream transmitter. Plotting them out, you can see the towers zigzag in 50 kilometer intervals. The zigzag ensures that any spillover from one tower doesn't affect the others down the line. The next issue was how to make the network support thousands of simultaneous calls. Not an easy feat when you've got just four antenna. Traditionally, a telephone works by having the sound waves of your voice vibrate a drum, moving a magnet within a wire coil, inducing an electric current. The current then moves another magnet drum pair to recreate the original sound. That's dead simple to build, but you can only carry one call per line. Radio stations operate on the same basic principle, but do the actual transmission bit by having the low frequency voice modulate a much higher carrier frequency. To avoid interference, nearby stations have to use different carriers, and you can tune into whatever station you're interested in by just cutting into whatever frequency range is the relevant one. Long lines could have worked by using lots and lots of antennas, each transmitting their own subtly different frequency, but that would have ended up being even more expensive than line copper in the first place. Instead, we use something known as multiplexing, basically like a prism that could turn white light into a rainbow and a rainbow back into white light. You start out with multiple calls, and then modulate them to different carrier frequencies. Then the multiplexer combines them together. You transmit the multiplex signal using a single antenna, receive it with another single antenna, demultiplex and demodulate to get back the original messages. You can multiplex basically any medium. Copper and radio support about 50 calls apiece, but microwave can do 7,000. The only drawback to using microwave on long lines was that occasionally they'd end up frying an unsuspecting pigeon. All that processing takes place here in the control center, basically a bunker attached to the main tower. Signals come in and are processed by the servers, which demultiplex them, check to see where they're going, do a bit of cleanup, and send them on. This is the actual antenna component. It takes in signals via coax cable, electrical energy turned into microwaves here with the radiating element, and then a copper waveguide brings it out the bunker, across to the tower, and then all the way up to the horns at the very top. With the technical details mostly worked out, it was time to build the network. New York, Boston, and Chicago were the first to try it out. After the war, steel was in short supply, so this first batch of towers were made almost exclusively of concrete. However, by 1955, improvements in steel manufacturing made prefabbed metal towers economically viable, and they soon bloomed across the Midwest. As the Cold War warmed up, the government realized the importance of secure long-distance communications and pressured AT&T for more advanced stations with hardened nuke-proof antenna. Still growing, the network spilled over to the West Coast. Massive hubs were built, incorporating their horns as much for aesthetics as for communication. After 15 years and 2,000 towers, the beacons were lit. America called for telecom. By the 1970s, the network was carrying more than a million long-distance calls every single day. And prices fell from the modern equivalent of $200 a minute down to just five. On top of that, you could talk to anyone, anywhere, not just in the major cities. Soon, TV was getting in on the action, and networks streamed the presidential debates, moon landings, and Watergate. In the days of dial-up, long lines was the internet, and the reason it sounds so weird is because it was using the same frequencies and technology as a regular phone call. Things couldn't last though, and long lines ended up being a victim of its own success. With all the money they were making, AT&T reinvested it in new telecom technologies. Things like TV satellites and fiber optic replaced these major use cases. A single fiber cable can now carry more than a billion simultaneous calls. Or, yeah, about one YouTube video. Slowly, the network was abandoned, with the very last tower going offline in the December of 1992. That would have been the end of it, if not for the fact that these towers were built in some of the most strategic locations in the country, high up on hills with views all around, and bunkers built to survive Armageddon. Near cities, often cell phone equipment is bolted onto the sides, while between them they're used as relay stations for fiber optic. A couple have even been repurposed by the government. However, a few had an even more lucrative destiny. Dan Manesto always wanted to be an engineer. However, after realizing that a career in finance could pay significantly better than one in aerospace, he switched his attention to high-speed trading. The United States has two major financial centers, the New York Stock Exchange and the Chicago Mercantile Exchange, separated by 1,100 kilometers. If you can make a trade in New York based on information gleaned in Chicago and you're first one to act on that new information, then you can make a guaranteed profit. In 2007, Dan was brought in to work for Calversafine Partners, with the goal of turning unhealthy amounts of coffee into nanosecond improvements with their software. He wrote good code, but soon realized that the real profits were to be made if it could beat the competition outright with a faster link. By the mid-2000s, the accepted way of sending telecommunications long distance was to use fiber optic cable, and the way of beating a competition was to take a shortcut through something that they'd gone around, like blasting a hole through an inconvenient mountain, often at the inconvenient cost of hundreds of millions of dollars. Dan's firm didn't have that sort of capital, so instead he was tasked with renting other people's links in order to put together an optimal route. According to the speed of light, you should be able to do that in about 3.9 milliseconds. However, nothing Dan could find was doing it faster than 7. The way fiber optic works is by sending a pulse laser light down a piece of glass, which bounces off the sides due to total internal reflection. That only works because light inside the glass is going much slower than on the outside, and it's this difference that causes it to bend around when it reaches the interface. That's great if you want to avoid obstacles, but not so good for a high-speed link. If instead you could send microwaves through the atmosphere, which had no such slowdown, then you could get a guaranteed speed-up, leapfrogging the competition. Working in secret, Dan spun up a shell company, and hired engineers whose first jobs have been working on the original long lines link, and were now well into retirement. The original AT&T monopoly had since been broken up into smaller monopolies, and by working with those, Daniel was able to rent space on their towers. A couple came from the original long lines network, although others had been built in the decades since. 2 years and $9 million later, the network came online, and latency dropped from 7 milliseconds down to just 4.2. The company raked in profit to the tune of $500,000 a week, and to everyone else, it looked like Dan had just broken the speed of light. Of course, they eventually caught on and started building their own links, and today, microwave is more popular than ever. The spirit of long lines lives on. For a time, long lines carried the chatter of a civilization. But today stand a silent vigil amongst the infrastructure of a digital world. Of course, from the Great Plains to mountaintops and our modern metropolis, it's all still here, if you know where to look. This has been James Dingle from the Atomic Frontier. Keep looking up. Ahoy there, it is I, Captain Sailout. Long lines brought mass communication to the Americas, and with it, media conglomerates with the ability to rock the story in their favor. Many a sailor has been lost to the seas of misinformation, taken avast by pretty truths and half-lies. Fortunately, we have Ground News to peer through the fog. Ground News is a website that trawls the ocean of modern media, gathering stories from around the world and across the political spectrum. It compares stories for their factuality, who is paying their dues, and looks at what biases they might have. On June 9th, 2024, Ernest Shackleton's ship, the Quest, was discovered 390 meters beneath the frigid waters off the Canadian coast. In the preceding week, 120 articles were written on the discovery. On the left, Gizmodo focuses on the explorer, Ernest Shackleton. The central government broadcasters talk about the ship. And to the right, Nine News focuses on the profoundly moving experiences of scientists who were actually making the discovery. See how, depending where you get your news from, you could have a different perspective. To chart your own course and broaden your horizons in a way that's free of bias, sail over to ground.news/atomicfrontier. And use my link for 40% off unlimited access. That's the one I use. Supporting them supports my work. Thanks, Ground News.